hidden treasures of the Himalayas. In this session, the next session, the Great Himalayan National Park in Himachal and some rare Himalayan plants come together. I would like to invite the panelists to come onto the stage, please. Sanjeev Pandey, Vinay Tandon, Bikram Grewal, Dr. Naresh Swami, and Dr. Ranjitsinh ji. Just a request, please, ladies and gentlemen, may we have some silence here? This is a request for some silence here so that the panelists can start talking. Can people please settle down at the back? Sanjeev Pandey has served as the director of the Great Himalayan National Park, GHNP, a hotspot of biological diversity in the Western Himalayas. His efforts with friends of GHNP have resulted in the area being marked as a World Heritage Site. Vinay Tandon, as Chief Conservator of Forests Himachal Pradesh, well-versed with the Himalayas, its flora and wildlife, is an avid reader of Khushwant Singh and an admirer of Khushwant Singh's Urdu connection. Dr. Naresh Swami was ordained as a temple priest at a very young age and has two doctoral degrees, the first one on butterflies and the second on plants and trees mentioned in the Vedas and Puranas. And he is currently working on orchids in the Himalayas. Bikram Grewal gave up his immensely successful career in publishing to devote his time to the conservation of wildlife. He has written over 30 books on birds of the subcontinent and conceived of the Birds of India website. The interlocutor for this panel will be Dr. M.K. Ranjit Singh. He was former chairman of the Wildlife Trust of India and also an MP Cadre IAS officer. He shaped the state's forest reserve policy for over two decades and is responsible for the establishment of more wildlife sanctuaries than any other person. Hidden treasures of the Himalayas, in keeping with Khushwant Singh's interest in the ecology.
Thank you. As a matter of fact, the first article that I ever wrote and published was at the behest of Mr. Khushwant Singh when he was the editor of the Illustrated Weekly of India, and I wrote an article way back in 71 called The Children of the Ganga, which is wildlife. But it's not about me and Mr. Khushwant Singh that we're going to talk about, but about a subject which is probably the most relevant that has come up so far. We are in the Himalayas and we should talk about the Himalayas. This is a book which is published by, if I may say so, a baby. You don't speak about human beings or male members as baby, but anyway, four very outstanding, very committed people who have contributed immensely to conservation and particularly to the setting up of the Himalayan National Park. I would like to say something about the Himalayas, if I may. Of all the great mountain ranges of the world, the longest is the Andes, little over 23,000 kilometers long. The shortest, tallest, yes, but the shortest is the Himalayas, just about 5,500 or thereabouts kilometers long. My favorite subject is mountain animals. And of the 43 large mountain mammals that exist in the world today, according to my count, something like 28 exist in the Himalayas. And only 3 in the Andes. I have seen more than that. I've seen 7 large mammals, from the wild yak to the wolf, in one day, in one nala in Changchenmo, Ladakh. That's twice as much that exists in the longest mountain range of the world. It's sad that we do not appreciate the Himalayas, and we do not appreciate its magnificent fauna and the flora to the extent that we should. Wildlife today, unfortunately, suffers, and I'm being rather caustic, and I should be forgiven for that, from a disease. It's called MMM, Mega Mammal Myopia. We are blinded by the large mammals. And the worst form of MMM is TT, tiger transfixation. If you've seen the tiger, you've seen everything. If you have not seen the tiger, you've seen nothing. And people go about brandishing this fact that to save the tiger, you save the wildlife of India. Probably there isn't a greater votary of the tiger than yours sincerely. I was a member secretary which started Project Tiger. It's a magnificent animal, but it blinds people. Beyond the tiger, you want to see nothing else. So, one has to have a larger vision. And in this country where symbolism matters so much, there has to be symbols. The tiger has been responsible for saving so many forest types, and so has the elephant, so has the rhinoceros. The snow leopard should be the flagship species for the mountains, so and so much as the whale shark for the coastlands and the great Indian bustard for our grasslands. But to focus on the Himalayas and the Himalayan fauna is paramount. And Himalayas have this great biodiversity because we today have not only the Great Himalayan Divide and the ranges which are before that, but Trans-Himalaya, which I read in Shamsan's book, has been described as the real frontier of India, and I agree. The real frontier of India is not the Himalayas, it's Trans-Himalaya. And the Great Himalayan National Park encompasses, and it's 2,800 square kilometers of territory, the Great Himalayan National Park, the Pin Valley, the Pin National Park, Kirthan, Indarkila, Sanj, Rupi Baba, a whole gamut of extremely diverse and remarkably free. The Himalayas are the most populated mountain range in the world. And so far as our Thar Desert is the most populated desert in the world, for obvious reasons. But this is a chunk where human habitation hasn't made the impact that it has elsewhere. And that's why it has to be cherished, why it has to be protected, and why this book is important. I leave it at that, and I would request all the 4 to speak turn by turn, but especially the main author, my friend Sanjeeva. And at the end, I would like very much some feedback and some questions. Otherwise, it just becomes rather a boring monologue. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, as Dr. Ranjitsinh just said, Himachal is the home of some of the finest national parks in this country, but mostly unsung. the park that we're going to talk about, the Great Himalayan National Park, has less than 1,000 visitors a year. Whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, I do not know. Other parks have 1,000 visitors a day or more. And I think it's a good thing. But it's so beautiful. You are the keepers of some of the most pristine forests in this country. But like I said, it's largely unknown and unsung. So it's very important that today, Sanjeeva, my friend Sanjeeva Pandey, who has done so much to protect the park, has written a book about it, which the first copy I'm very privileged to have in my hand, and it will soon be available in the market. And may I request M.K. Ranjitsinh ji to please open the first copy. And like I said, it'll be in the market very, very soon. Sanjeeva, congratulations. We'll, you know, as a bird watcher, as an ornithologist, Himachal has some of the finest bird life in India. But the thunder has been really stolen by adjacent Uttaranchal, which has a thriving business in bird watching. This has created jobs. Villagers have opened homestays. There are guides. And it's really thriving in both Kumaon and in Garhwal. I don't know if Himachal has missed a trick. I'm sure that we have with us four very, very fine forest officers who will speak about it. But we are quite short of time. But I will only speak about one key species, which is the western tragopan, possibly the most beautiful bird in India, is the size of a jungli murgi, but spectacularly colored. And the Great Himalayan National Park is the best place to see it. And it's a bird that's very difficult to see, so you have to give yourself a fair amount of time and walk a fair deal. It's more heard than seen. There are other birds, over 300 species of birds can easily be seen. There are pristine rivers, there's snow-fed streams which are home to all the river birds. There are pine forests, there's mammals. Dr. Ranjitsinh spoke about mammals of the Himalayas. But everything is under stress. The Great Himalayan National has always had a tradition of businessmen sending in very poor people to go and search for the Gucci mushrooms and other herbs. So that is a threat. But here we are, today we're not going to talk about the problems which beset us all over. We are the worst time in our lives, in our, this thing. The wildlife in this country is under so much pressure that you can't even believe it. Dr. Ranjitsinh and I are working together on saving the great Indian bustard, which in both our opinions are less than 100 left in the world. It'll be the first bird to go extinct in our lifetimes, but nobody cares. Nobody's scared, cares nothing, neither the government nor the people. But we'll talk about the Great Himalayan National Park. Sanjeeva, would you come up and tell us about your experience? You were both the director and you've done so much for the park.
Thank you, Bikram, and thank you, sir. Lots of thanks to Dr. M.K. Ranjitsinh. He is the one who has, in fact, framed our Indian Wildlife Protection Act. So, and today it's really great pleasure for me that my book has been untied by him. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Coming to the actual presentation. Okay, I'll do it faster. Namaskar, sir. And this is actually, you have already seen me, and this is my second author here, because he's not present. He's Dr. Tony Gaston from Canadian Wildlife Service, and he has also retired like me, and he is in love with Great Himalayan National Park. So he has been coming here. You can see the the surveys over there, 1978 and 80. So that is the time when he undertook the surveys. And on the recommendation of his surveys, the result of surveys, the government of Himachal Pradesh notified the Great Himalayan National Park in 1984, and then the things have started happening. I'll be a little bit faster here because I have to show you a number of slides about the park. And the book deals about a history and ecological overview of the park. That is the basic of the book. And it's also a plea. It's a plea for continuing conservation of wildlife in Himalayas. And then the book is very, very people-centric. Because in case we want to conserve our wildlife or our animals and all, we have to take care of the people who are living next to a protected area, next to the Great Himalayan National Park. And the book explores how local people, they look at nature, you know, their own folklores, their own folk tales, the songs, mountain deities that they have, devbans, devta trees, and all these have been integrated in the park management, starting by my work when I was there at the Great Himalayan National Park and now continuing. So just see this particular bird, and that is the Western Tragopan. Here is a painting done on that particular bird. And this bird, as the local people say, a very small story I like to say, that on the day when God was creating this universe, you know, in the forenoon he created very, very small, you know, we call them in local language piddas, you know, small birds. And after his lunch, after the siesta, when God woke up, he was very energetic, and he says, he calls all those birds whom he created in the forenoon, you come over and donate your best feather. And out of that best feather, or most beautiful feather that these birds donated, God created this particular bird known as Western Tragopan. And each of that dot over there on the body of the bird denotes that feather of those small birds. So that is the way it exists in the folklore. You can see the male and female over there. Female in among all, virtually all the pheasants, like you see in peacock also, they are drab in color, but males are very beautiful to attract the females. And that is the nuptial dance, in fact, of Great Himalayan National Western Tragopan in Great Himalayan National Park. And you can see the two sapphire color horns on the top of the head of the bird. And that is how the bird is also known by the local people as Singhwala bird. That means Western Horned Tragopan. And how does it exist in the folklore? You can see that there. See, that is on the eastern side of this map of Himachal Pradesh, there is Uttarakhand. In Uttarakhand, we do not have this particular species. We have a different species of Tragopan over there. But starting from Sangla area, Sangla Valley of Himachal Pradesh, the bird is known as Pyara. Next district is Shimla or Bushehr state, where it is known as Jazi. And then as you go into Kullu, it is known as Juju Rana. Juju Rana means, Juju is bird and Rana means king. So it's king of the birds. And as you go further up towards Chamba and Kangra, it is known as Fulgar. Little bit of this is found in JNK and very small area of POK. So that is the worldwide distribution. I'm just telling you one single species, because this is one of the most vulnerable species, red data listed of IUCN, which is found in this particular area. About this area, in case we really want to talk about people, then we have to see how do they live. And these are kind of houses that you see over there, very much like you go to Switzerland, you see all those chalets and all. I mean, this is just like that. In case we want to conserve that, we can do it even now. But as the roads are coming in, these houses are getting into, you know, concrete structures. So this is how people do, like we say in parlance of forest management, JFM, Joint Forest Management. This is what they do on their own. It's known as Juari. Juari means on a particular day, local people, they will come together for doing a particular common work. So out here they are doing the paddy planting of paddy in their fields. So then people have their own national parks. I mean, they have small ones, like 6 hectare or 10 hectare or maybe 20 hectares at the most, and they are known as Day1. And they are all over Himalayas, but particularly in Kullu district, virtually every panchayat has them, you know, these Day1s. So that is the way how collection of medicinal herbs, they will pray here, and then they will start on the journey. Then this is how the shamans, they work, and now we keep on approaching them, and then they tell local people not to kill wildlife, not to hunt, not to poach. So that sort of a thing happening there, and they are the real help in conservation of wildlife. The second picture is of a temple which shows that Shaivism and Buddhism, they are coming together, and Buddhism, they really tell people not to kill. So that is yet another important thing in conservation in the park. Out here, this is like, I was told that this is Nari Shakti thing, the theme of this particular lit fest. So out here, there is a little bit different. You can see these kind of places of God, which have been placed on very, very high mountains. So this is basically Kali Mata, you know. So one villager has explained to me that what do they do, that they will place Kali Mata, that means female, you know, at a lower height. Then the other one, that's the next one, this is Shivji, that is Kailash. So that was about 3,700 meters, and this is about 5,772 meters. So the male god is always placed high out here. That is how it exists in, at least in this area in Great Himalaya National Park. Yeah, I'm just seeing that. And now how people look at these origin of rivers over there. This is the origin of Tithan River. This is Sanj River. There are 4 major rivers in the park. And this is very nice tarn, T-A-R-N, you know. This is a glacial lake out of which Jivanal comes out. And then this is Parvati River. So these are 4 major rivers that make the Great Himalaya National Park about 1,000 square kilometers. This is how people live over there, and their Kathkuni style homes, which are totally earthquake proof. These are kind of views you see during winters. I mean, totally frozen waterfalls. These are towering fir trees in the park. And these are some of the views of the national park you can see here. And this is how we conduct our, tracks in the park. So this is Pin Parvati Pass, which is a very, very high pass, and 5,319 meters high. So this is one track which I myself was leading. About 7 kilometers you have to walk on the snow. And these are again some views of Great Himalaya National Park, and very recent, in September last month only, you can see the bouquet of natural thing over there. And all these things put together, that is in 2014 we have finally got inscription of World Heritage Site for the Great Himalaya National Park, UNESCO inscription. So this is just after that. Thank you so much. And we have been working for that quite hard. And the inscription is only on one thing, that is biological diversity of the park. So that is criteria number 10 over there. And these are the celebrations after the inscriptions in the eco zone by the local people over there. And in case we really want to have number of ecosystem services like water or fresh air and all, then we have to have these kind of areas well protected. And that is, I mean, the kind of sky, I mean, you will miss it anywhere else, but Great Himalaya National Park has it all. And this is friends of GHNP who have come together, and they have volunteered their time and energy for the park. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
We have only about 7 minutes left, And I would request the other two speakers to come in, please. Mr. Vinay Tandon, who is Chief Wildlife Ward. We've been colleagues in the Ministry of Environment. And I would like him to speak, not just about the National Park, which is really a microcosm of the ecological diversity of the Western Himalayas, and with 46 peaks of over 5,000 meters high. But I would especially like him to talk about the realignment or the rationalization of the boundaries of the park, in which he played a very crucial role. And this has been a model that while we reduce certain areas of the park simultaneously, and he was the chief wildlife warden who suggested, sir, pehle ye kahiyega ke unko notify kare in lieu of that. Today we are resorting to accession of boundaries of the park, and people pay money into campa funds, which is used for making roads and rest houses. This is the kind. If a park boundary is to be cut, it should be not sold for money, it should be substituted. And he was, and I cite this always as an example, and he is one of the progenitors of it. Please. Sorry.
Thank you, sir. Well, I think, am I audible?
Yes.
I think you've really summed it up. I was of the thought that we'll have a little different note. There is a couplet which comes to my mind. Nale bulbul ke sunu, nale bulbul ke sunu, aur hamatam ghosh rahun, hamna wa main bhi koi gul hoon ke khamosh rahun. This is, of course, from the epic poem Shikwa. And Mr. Khushwant Singh, I think, incomparable translation into English of that poem. For want of time, I would have liked to go into this a little more. Nevertheless, talking about the formation, the site, the UNESCO status, Natural World Heritage Site, there has been an underlying and constant sort of struggle and an endeavor at the same time, which actually is very close to the theme of this KSLITFEST, the strength of a Nari. You're all aware that forestry essentially and later wildlife has been man's world. It was about in 2000 that a first step to what we call feminization of forestry began in Himachal, and government came out with a policy that 20% of forest guards must be ladies. That has been by and large followed. However, the regulations can only go that far. And in the book here, Mr. Sanjeeva's Pandey book, there are examples which have happened on the ground of mobilization of village women. And we know now through various studies, researches and so on, that women, village women, who are actually the main users of natural products, are crucial to sustaining not just biodiversity but even ecosystems. There are examples of, for instance, across the villages of the ecozone forming women's groups, and I am sure that this needs to be sort of carried on, pushed towards having a more sustainable, and finally a sustainable, Great Himalayan National Park. Thank you.
Very quickly, I would request Dr. Swami to speak. There's very little time left, particularly on the flowers. There are over 800 species of flowering plants in the Himalayan National Park, and probably he may like to speak on the bugyals
and on the 30th.
Okay. Greetings to all. I am a botanist working in the eastern Himalaya, much further from this his territory. So I wish to talk to him about the, because of the time limitation also, I wish to talk about him about the making of the book, Pandeji. I work in a place where there are no human population, in a very remote place. But I understood that in the Himalayan greater park there are few villages, is it? Yeah, how they respond to the work? As an IFS officer, I know you have all the paraphernalia of the department with you. But how the human population responded to it? They were part of your work or in any time of the this? Because it might have taken 3-4 years for this to compiling all the data. They were part of it? Okay. And what about the species, you know, like he is working on birds, I am working on... Okay. He is working on birds, I am working on flowers. Is there a comprehensive list of any family in the book?
Actually, what we have done, we have started a thing known as LTEM. It's known as long-term ecological monitoring. So in case we have done it today, that is the base data, then over the years, like after 5 years or maybe 10 years, we can go back again and we can visit the transect lines in the park and see how the changes have occurred. So that is what we are doing for everything, for flora.
Flora as well as fauna.
Yes.
But do you think after 5 years when you are there, it will be intact? No roads will be there, no dams will be there?
Oh yes, luckily this is now a notified park and it is finally notified. So there is no road inside at all. And in a park area, you cannot do that as per Indian Wildlife Protection Act.
Yeah.
That is what we have talked about in fact.
Okay, how many species of dog?
Can we continue?
No. It's okay.
Okay. Once more, congrats to you, Pandeji.
Thank you.
And to all the panelists and to the first people.